I have to say that unfortunately our introducer could not be with us tonight. And this there's actually a really good reason in this particular case. His wife just went into labor. So it's really a very legitimate excuse. So you should all forgive him. And realizing, you know, these things tend to happen, you tend to have a little bit of advance warning that this might happen. So as a result, we do actually have the introducer captured. And so I've never introduced a video before. I usually don't introduce the introducer, but tonight I have to make an exception because it's my only opportunity to introduce a video. I'd like to introduce this lovely video. It's in HD. It's 1920 by 1080 pixels. I believe I got that correct. And it was recorded in a studio only about 100 miles from here. And I think you'll find this just to be a delightful little video. So let's roll that.
Good evening. My name is Zach Spiker, and I'm the head basketball coach at the United States Military Academy here at West Point. We use numbers all the time to evaluate whether our opponents are good shooters or poor shooters, from three-point land, from two-point land. There's a number of different areas. As we get ready to go into a game, we use numbers to evaluate our opponents as well as ourselves. When we're game planning, we want to get our best player the basketball where he has the highest rate of percentage to complete a play or a shot to help our team be successful. And we're studying those numbers and those areas of the court all the time. All right. Another person that uses sport and numbers at a very high level is a person named John Barrow. All right, John's going to talk to us tonight about the connection between math and sports. It's very appropriate considering one of MoMath's most popular new exhibits is designed to relate to basketball and math. All right, a couple things about John before he comes up to speak tonight. He's earned his doctorate in astrophysics, all right, at Oxford University in 1977. All right, he's currently a research professor for mathematics at the University of Cambridge. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of London, and he's having been awarded the Michael Faraday Prize for Excellence in Communication Science in the UK audiences in 2008. Obviously, he's a very well-established person who understands numbers and how they relate to sports. Okay? He's also published over 400 journal articles and 17 books for readers, including the 2012 Mathematics, A Scientist Explains 100 Amazing Things About the World of Sports. All right? So we're very excited to have John here today to speak to us even more about the topic of sport and math. So without further ado, please welcome John D. Barrow. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, John Barrow.
Well, thank you very much. I guess I should thank the Museum of Mathematics and Jim Simons for making it possible for me to come and talk to you, and apologize also for being neither Mr. Obama nor Mr. Romney. But you'll enjoy that later. Well, I want this evening to try to give you a flavor for the way maths impacts upon lots of different sports. So if you're a sports person, you may learn something new about your sport. If you're an educator or you're interested in mathematics, perhaps you'll learn something about how to present some ideas in mathematics in a slightly different way, or how to make a subject that might not have seemed terribly exciting a little more engaging for your students or for the people you talk to at the cafe or the bar. Well, I noticed that my title is Maths and Sports. Well, perhaps it should be Math and Sport. We usually say mathematics in Britain, actually. We don't like the abbreviation. But I want to start by talking about handedness and whether right-handers and left-handers have some advantage in sport. Human body is peculiar. From the outside, it's wonderfully symmetric as you look from left to right. And we tend to gauge whether we think people are attractive by the degree to which they're symmetrical to right to left. And great deal of money goes into restoring lateral symmetry from right to left. We don't have up-down symmetry because the force of gravity plays a role in structuring our bodies. And we don't have back-to-front symmetry because it was easier, less expensive for evolution to engineer the ability to turn around. Whereas if you're a tree, you have another degree of symmetry. But when you look on the inside of our bodies, we're a bit of a mess. We do have a handedness. The heart is on the left and and so on. So once you're inside the body, where no one notices and there's no sexual selection to be played towards, it doesn't matter whether you're symmetrical at all. But in sports, sometimes there can be a symmetry which is broken by the way the rules are set up. And when that happens, you'll find that there may be an advantage to someone who's left or right-handed. So just out of interest, how many people here are left-handed? Okay. How many people are right-handed? How many people are ambidextrous? So you look fairly typical, actually. About 10% of the general population are left-handed, and about 90% are right-handed, and sort of 1% or less are either ambidextrous or they do some things like me. I do some things with my left hand and some things with my right hand. Probably because when I was a child, it was a generation that if you tried to write with your left hand, someone would move the pen into your right hand. So I suspect I'm really left-handed, but was made to be right-handed for certain things. Well, those percentages tell you something about sports from the start. That if you're involved in a combat sport, say like fencing or boxing, then right-handers have a disadvantage because they rather less frequently encounter left-handed fighters. So left-handers encounter right-handed opponents 90% of the time, but right-handers only encounter left-handers 10% of the time. So those left-handers are a bit of a strange experience for the right-handed opponents. If you looked at the Olympic Games this summer, at the fencing, for example, you would find the fraction of left-handed contestants was much greater than the number in the general population or in this room. It was getting towards 40% as far as I could see. So you can see that people who were left-handed in fencing were perhaps exploiting this advantage over the years, and gradually you tend to get more of an equilibrium between right and left-handers in activities which are competitive. Where you want collaboration, if you want everybody defending the spiral staircase in the same way against the attackers, it pays all to be the same, to be all right-handed or all left-handed. So the fact that we have about 90% right-handers, 10% left-handers, in some ways a sort of a measure of the degree to which cooperation and competition relatively dictate human interactions historically. So this is a rather simple fact about right and left-handedness. But suppose we look at this symmetry breaking that you see in some sports. Well, if you take something like baseball, we call it rounders in Britain. There's a handedness in this game. You run around anti-clockwise. So if you stand there waiting to receive the ball and you hit the ball with your right, say, or your left hand, if you're a left-hander, you have an obvious advantage because you hit the ball in the direction that you're going to run. You're already moving in that direction as you go to hit the ball. Whereas if you hit with a right hand, you've got to check and move in the opposite direction. So it's one aspect of the game that has an advantage for a left-hander. If you look at athletics, track athletics, again, you run around the track in the anti-clockwise direction. There was a time at Oxford University long, long ago when they used to run the other way around the track just to be perverse. But there are some events where this is disadvantageous. If you're right-handed, right-footed, you will lead over the hurdles with your left leg and you will draw your right leg around the hurdles. So if you're right-handed, you will drag your trail leg around the outside of the hurdles. But if you're left-handed, left leg, you will lead with your right leg and you will drag your left trail leg around the inside of the hurdles. That's a really dangerous thing to do. You're very likely, like this gentleman here, to drag that inside leg not over the hurdle, but inside it, and then you'll be disqualified. So if you have that right leg lead in the 400-meter hurdles and you're not a superstar athlete that can change legs, you're really susceptible to being disqualified. You have to run much closer to the outside of the lane. So it's rather disadvantageous to you. A more interesting type of asymmetry I'd noticed this summer while watching the tennis is that tennis really does favor left-handed people. And I think many tennis players really admit that. And again, there's a symmetry breaking in this game. A choice has been made at the beginning. And the choice is that the first serve is going to be from this right-hand court, hit across here to the receiver. So if you're a right-handed player, that first serve is on your forehand, as it were. The next serve that's played in the game will be over here, and will be a bit awkward for you. You know, you'll be hitting it sort of on your backhand side. If you're a left-handed player, it would be on your forehand for the second point that's played. The third point, the third serve, is back on the forehand of the right-handed player. So you see the pattern here. The first, the third, all the odd-numbered points that are played are on the forehand court of the right-handed player. But the second, the fourth, the sixth, the even-numbered points are on the forehand of the left-handed player. Now, what are the key points? These are the match points in the set. So when you reach 40 love, when you reach 40-30, when you reach advantage, what hand is the next point on? And for the left-handed player, he's serving on his forehand when it's 40 love, when it's 40-30, and always when it's advantage. But the right-handed player only serves on their forehand for match point when it's 40-15. So a left-handed player has a big advantage the way the game is set up. So although it was perhaps created with right-handers in mind, the result has been to bias it towards left-handers. Well, let's move from handedness to a place in athletics where formulae and mathematical mapping plays a perhaps unnoticed part. In any of the multi-discipline events like the decathlon or the heptathlon, you probably know enough about them to know that there are a number of different events. There's throwing, there's jumping, and there's running. And the performances are combined by turning them into points, and the points are added up. So how do you turn them into points? So some mathematical scheme has to be used to convert distances and times into points, which you then total. So these are the events that you have in the decathlon. This is Ashton Eaton, great American athlete who set a new world record in the decathlon this summer at the American Trials. And he's the most unusual athlete, even by decathlete standards, we'll see in a moment. He's not at all typical of previous world record holders. And the heptathlon, where Britain's Jessica Ennis won the gold medal in London, and Eaton won the gold medal in London as well. So in the heptathlon, you have 200 meters high jump, long jump, 100 meters hurdles, and 800 meters and javelin and shot put. And here the running events are along the top, and here are the throwing events, and here are the jumping events, plus the pole vault. So this takes place over 2 days, 10 events. Some masochists even have a version of this event where you have to do it in 1 hour. And the world records are really quite remarkable for that one-hour event. Well, what happens? How do you get points out of performances? Well, what happens is that a power law formula is created for each of the events. And this power law formula converts the performances into points. And the points scored in an event where you want to have the biggest distance possible, so throwing or jumping, will look like some number multiplied by the distance minus some cutoff below which you don't score any points. Okay? But then the important thing is raised to this power, C. In the case of the running events where you want to have the shortest time possible, this factor's turned around. And the cutoff is minus the time. So if you have a time longer than the cutoff B, you'll be given no points. The interesting thing is this C factor up here. So if that factor were to be bigger than 1, this is a point scoring which is progressive. And as you get better and better with your performances, you're rewarded proportionately more. If that number was 1, then the reward remains equal. So it's a neutral system. Whereas if it's less than 1, you're getting less and less credit as you get better and better. Well, as you might guess, these scoring systems are fairly progressive. And the way those numbers A and B and C are defined for each event use historical records in decathlons. They use records in the ordinary contestants in those events. And what you find down here, these are what the numbers are. Forget about A and B, pretty much. They're not too exciting. The interesting thing is this power law index. And if you look at the running events, the 100 meters, the 400, the 1500, the values statistically all cluster around 1.8 and 1.9. So you have this sort of common statistical factor from the records for the running events. When you go to the jumps, they tend to cluster around 1.4, here for the pole vault, the high jump, and the long jump. Whereas for the throws, they're barely progressive at all. So for the throws, you get relatively little credit for being better. So these are around 1.05, 1.1, 1.08. They're really very close to 1. So you get a lot more credit for the runs and the jumps than you do for the throws. So if we look, and the women's heptathlon has almost exactly the same clustered values. Here's a chart which shows what you would need to do to get close to the world record if you were scoring 900 points for each event. Originally, the standards were set, so 1,000 points was the world record long ago. So if you got 900 points for every event, this is how you would have to do it. And then you would have 9,000, and you would be challenging Mr. Eaton's world record of 9,039. When laid out like this, these are not very, they're not super impressive. I suspect there are people in this audience who might be able to run 10.83. You know, it's a good high school performance, champion high school performance. 1,500 meters, 4 minutes 7, I could run faster than that when I was 15 years old. 48.19, a good club athlete standard. So the crux here is that if you were to be trying to make that score by being the same at every event, it's that sameness that really counts. You'd have to be a runner, a jumper, a thrower. And in practice, if you look at the stats, what I've done here is to gather up the 100 all-time best performances in the decathlon and to see where people got their points. And that's what the bar charts are. Okay, it's the 100 meters, the long jump, that should say 400. And one of the things you notice about this is that there is huge variance. Okay, if this event were structured by mathematicians or statisticians and designed to be totally fair across all the events, so that someone who was a shot putter would feel that they could take up this event and be as successful as a sprinter, these bar charts should all have about the same height. But in fact, they have huge variance. They're all over the place. These red bars that go off the top of the slide, they're Ashton Eaton's performances. They're even more extreme. So he ran the fastest ever 100 meters, 10.2 in a decathlon, the longest ever long jump in a decathlon, and I think the second fastest 400 meters in a decathlon. So, and he does really poorly in these events down here. So the message of these stats is if you want to be a successful decathlete, you should be a sprinter jumper. Because if you're a good sprinter, you'll be a good long jumper, you'll be a good hurdler. If you want to say, how should I spend my training time? You should spend your training time predominantly sprinting. Because it'll pay off in the 100, in the hurdles, in the 400 meters, and in the long jump. Do not bother spending a lot of time doing cross-country runs and 1,500 meter training, because you won't get very much return for that. The throwers, top throwers, do not really get a very good return for their high levels of ability. So a mathematical look at this scoring table structure tells you something about the structuring of the event that would hold for all multi-performance events. I invented a quick new way to score this event with no points involved at all. Call it the Barrow total. And I just take the performances which want you to maximize what you do, the jumps and the throws, multiply all the distances together, and divide by the times in all the events that want you to minimize the time. You have a final score that's got units of distance to the power 6 divided by time to the power 4. But if you work out what it is for Mr. Eaton, it's 1.92. For Sebrelet, who was the previous world record, it's 2.29. And Vorjak, who's the third best ever, it's 2.40. So the rankings of the top three are reversed in this scheme. Of course, it has its own biases, and it's giving a lot of credit to those throws. So in any type of event where it's triathlon, for example, modern pentathlon, heptathlon, as well as decathlon, where performances are converted into points, there's a mathematical and statistical issue to be addressed about how you do it. Well, staying with something that's athletic, which is on the poster for this talk, why do high jumpers use the Fosbury flop? What's going on there? Dick Fosbury introduced this technique into high jumping in 1968. He won the Olympic gold medal in Mexico City that year, and he introduced this technique throughout that season. He won the US trials. He never set a world record, but he jumped 7'4", I think, in imperial units to win the gold medal in Mexico City. It's not a mystery as to why this technique was not developed earlier. That year was the year where around the world and at the Olympic Games, for the first time, you had airbed landing areas. Previous Olympic Games, you'll be landing in sand. It's bad enough landing in sand from a world record height of 7'6¾ at the time, but to land on your head is not advisable. So nowadays, I think every single world-class high jumper, national-class high jumper, uses this technique. And there are two reasons for doing that. One rather pragmatic reason is it's very easy to learn. So in the days when people used a straddle technique, they would still curve over the bar like this, but the other way round. So they had their chest close to the bar. So all the things that are sort of dangling around, like your knees and your ankles and your fingers and your wrists, are facing the bar, and they can knock the bar off. This method, you can do what you want with your hands and your knees and your feet. They're facing away from the bar. So there is far less technique involved in learning this high jumping technique. But both techniques are doing something that's rather subtle, that applied mathematician recognizes, that if you have a curved object, whether it's a banana or a V-shape, then the center of gravity of that object does not lie within the body of the object. The center of gravity of Stefan Holm here, winning the gold medal in the Athens Olympics, this gentleman's very remarkable. So he's not only Olympic champion, okay, he can jump over 2.40 meters, but he's only my height. Okay. So the world record holder can jump 2.45 meters, but he's 2 meters tall. So Holm is very remarkable in being normal size. And he has this fantastic flexibility. His center of gravity is going underneath the bar, but his body is going over the bar. If you're a physicist, think of this as a classical version of the quantum tunneling effect. Okay? And there may be more to that remark than you think. But so if at school, when you're very, very young, you're taught to high jump, you use this scissors technique. You just sort of hop over the bar. It's very inefficient. Your center of gravity is going way over the bar, and your body is going over the bar. But with the Fosbury technique, your center of gravity is going under the bar. You are slithering over the bar. What you do when you high jump is that you convert kinetic energy of motion, you run in with some kinetic energy, a half mv squared, and you convert it into potential energy of work against gravity. And that potential energy looks like your weight, your mass times acceleration due to gravity, times the height that you raise your center of gravity. So you raise it an amount from sort of here up to that point where it goes under the bar. So if you can make your center of gravity go under the bar as low as possible, you will make optimal use of that kinetic energy that you've run in. So this is why this technique is used both in pole vaulting and in high jumping. Let's look at something else that people think has got something to do with center of gravity, and you're going to have to do something like this yourself in a minute. This gentleman, probably well known in New York, back in the 70s, walking between the Twin Towers, Philippe Petit, tightrope walker. And like all tightrope walkers that you see walking between buildings or across the Niagara Falls or in the circus, they're always carrying long poles. Why do they carry long poles? Well, if you stop the average person in the street and ask them why the tightrope walkers carry long poles, if they answer at all, they probably think it's something to do with center of gravity. You know, isn't it? Doesn't it make your center of gravity lower so you're more stable? In fact, it makes center of gravity higher, so that's not a good idea. So what's going on here? Sometimes you see people like Mr. Houdini in historic pictures with great buckets of sand on the end of the poles. So weight on the end of the poles. Well, what's going on here is nothing to do with center of gravity. It's to do with something a little more subtle. It's what physicists and engineers and mathematicians call inertia, or moment of inertia if you study it in a course. It's really about the distribution of mass. So what matters if you want to shift something, if you want to push something along, some big ball of rock or something, is not just its weight, but how that weight is distributed. And if the weight is concentrated towards the center, then you'll find it's much easier to move that object. It has a low inertia. That's why the word is used. So if your children have high inertia, they don't get up, they don't move, they don't do things. So they resist motion. And similarly with massive objects. If you have two identical balls with the same size, same diameter, same radius, same mass, same weight, so they look the same from the outside, they're made out of different materials, but one is hollow and one is solid. How would you find out which was which? Well, if you rolled one down a hill or you spun one round, you would find that this one was much harder to move. Okay? It would roll more slowly than the solid one. So it's got a higher inertia. So mathematically, this inertia looks like proportional to the mass of the object, to the square of its radius or its diameter. And then there's some concentration factor that tells you how the mass is concentrated or distributed. And in the case of a solid sphere like this, with an even distribution of the mass, that factor's 2/5. But when it's all in the surface and it's a shell, it's a little bit bigger, it's 2/3. So the message here is the more mass you have far from the center, the harder it is to move, and you'll move more slowly. So what's going on with our tightrope walker? By holding the pole, they're increasing their inertia. They're increasing their moment of inertia by moving some mass further from their center. And if they had those buckets on the end, it would be even better. So that when they wobble more slowly. They didn't have the pole. Once they started to wobble, they wouldn't be able to control it so easily and so quickly, and they'd tend to fall off. Well, I think you're going, at the end, you're going to experiment for this yourselves with trying to walk along some of these lines here. So you find that if you want to walk along a line and you hold your arms in, it's a little harder than if you put your arms out, just like the tightrope walker. So the next time you're at the police station having to sort of blow into the bag and so on, remember this, okay? And similarly, this is not what this is for, but every other person has got one of these under their seats, but if you balance a very long ruler on your finger, it will be easier to do it than if it was very short, if you were balancing your pencil. Because again, you've got more time, the oscillation frequency is lower, you've got more time to correct. Well, inertia, this distribution of mass, is something that dominates all sorts of sporting events. And things like gymnastics, for example, we'll see in a moment, part of the game is to change the inertia of your body, to alter its stability characteristics. One place where you see what we've just been saying played out, cycling is a big deal in Britain. We're the best at cycling by a long way. We win all the gold medals at the Olympic Games. And here's Bradley Wiggins, who has 5 Olympic gold medals, and he won the Tour de France this year as well. And Bradley Wiggins' bike's not like my bike because it's got these disc wheels. If you try to cycle down the street with disc wheels on the front, you'll soon end up on the ground, because as soon as the wind catches the wheel to the side, it'll flip round and you'll fall off. But on the velodrome track, you can do that. What's going on? Remember what I said. The moment of inertia of the disc, okay, the solid ball, is smaller than the moment of inertia of the ring. In fact, the moment of inertia of the ring, like your bike, is twice as big as for the disc. So the disc wheel, when you apply force on the pedal, it responds quicker because its inertia is smaller. You can't use that on a road bike at the front for the reasons I said, but you can do it on the back. So you often on road bikes, you see the disc on the back, but then you're just trying to minimize the mass and the wheel on the front. So everywhere you see wheels, there are people thinking about how can I reduce the inertia? How can I make the wheel respond faster to an applied force? Well, mass distribution of a wheel, which is almost two-dimensional, is one thing, but sometimes you have objects which are three-dimensional, like this racket or the human body. And then there are different mass distributions in different directions. So if we look at this object, there is a mass distribution from right to left, and if you look at it end-on, there's a mass distribution up and down, and if we were to look from the side, there will be another one. So in practice, three-dimensional objects have got three different distributions of inertia in the three different perpendicular directions. Well, each of those directions you can rotate about. So I can rotate this racket vertically, I can lay it flat on the ground and rotate it like that, or I can rotate it like this. Now, one of the great theorems of mathematics, thanks to Leonard Euler, the great Swiss mathematician of the past, is that of those three inertias, one is going to be the biggest, one is going to be the smallest, and one is going to be the in-between, sort of Goldilocks inertia. Well, the rotation around the biggest and the smallest axes of inertia is stable, but rotation about the in-between axis is not. It's unstable. What does that mean? Well, on this racket, so I've got up here, okay, the in-between axis of inertia is this one. So if I throw this in the air, that's now facing down. So the racket has done a flip as it's done one rotation because the rotation is unstable about that axis. This is now up. You can try this for yourself. Those little marker things that you've got underneath your seat. So if you sort of have Stabilo Boss facing upwards and you just throw it around 360 degrees, you'll find it's then facing downwards. I thought it was too dangerous to allow you these squash rackets, but so I hope you can see this. If you were to spin it, of course, around the other axes, you know, like that, then it's stable. So this instability is vitally important for athletes in events like gymnastics. So if one of you, you know, would want to do a series of somersaults, I'll pick someone in a moment, along here, you've seen gymnasts do this. They'll do a sequence of tightly wound somersaults, making sure that the axis then that they're spinning around is not the intermediate axis. And they will keep tumbling, and then they will open the body out, and then that axis becomes the intermediate one, and with the last somersault, they do the twist, and they end up facing the direction that they've come from. And if you're really clever, you can do that on the 9-inch beam as well. So all over gymnastic events, you see this skill being demonstrated of gymnasts changing the principal moments of inertia, as we call them, of their body, so that when they rotate, they will do that twist unavoidably. You get more points for doing the twist, but you can't avoid doing it. Okay? It's a law of mechanics. Well, there are all sorts of other events where you see that type of thing come into play. Rotation, okay, depends on inertia, the so-called angular momentum is conserved, the inertia multiplied by the spin rate. And if we look at an ice skater, my daughter's professional ice skating coach, so I sort of have to watch this sort of thing quite frequently, when your arms are out and you start the spin, your inertia is large. You've got a fair bit of mass away from your center. As you draw your arms in, your inertia decreases and you spin faster. Another less obvious place, if you look at runners, so if you look at top class middle distance runner, 800 meters for example, they will tend to run rather neatly with their arms very close to their body. What they're doing is keeping their inertia low so that if they suddenly have to change lane or respond to something, a little bit of effort will produce a big response. But if you watch a cross-country runner running up on uneven ground or going uphill, they tend to run like this. Okay, their arms away from their body, inertia larger. So if you miss your footing and you stumble a bit, you won't easily move a long way. So again, you manipulate your body's inertia to suit what you're doing. And the high board divers, again, doing the same thing as the tumblers along the floor here. Eventually, you'll open up your body so that instead of doing a tight, stable somersault, you do an unstable, extended one, and then you get a twist for free. Well, let's leave these genteel activities and move on to something completely different. This little gentleman, who is retired now, is under 5 foot tall, but can lift more than three times his body weight. He was three times Olympic champion at the lowest weight. He would have been four times Olympic champion, but he changed nationality and couldn't compete the fourth time. And the interesting thing about weightlifting is that there are weight categories. And when you looked at the Olympics, this was often puzzling. There are events like hammer throwing, discus throwing, where strength clearly matters. And the bigger you are, you might think, well, the stronger you are. But there are no weight classes for hammer throwing or discus throwing or shot putting. But there are weight classes in weightlifting, and there are in wrestling, and there are in boxing. So this implicitly recognizes that if you are bigger, you're likely to be stronger. So can we, with just a little bit of simple mathematics, try and figure out how much stronger you get as you get bigger and see if our predictions fit the facts, okay? Well, if you want to measure the strength of something, whether it's your bone or a piece of wood, then what matters about it is not its total size, or its total volume, or its weight. Because if I want to break something, don't do this, but if I want to break this ruler, doesn't matter how long it is. All I've got to do is sever a little cross-section of molecular bonds through one slice of it. And if it extends all the way to the wall there, it won't be any harder for me to break that little area of bonds here. So what determines the strength of something is an area, a cross-sectional area, the number of atomic bonds that are in that little cross-section. And if you think of things as having some size, it could be their diameter, their radius, let's call it R, well, areas are proportional to size squared, typically. If it's a circle, the area is pi R squared. If it's an ellipse, it's a bit more complicated, but it's still proportional to some measure of the size squared. But the weight of something is still different. The weight is proportional to the mass, which is proportional to the density times the volume. Well, volume is proportional to size cubed. Okay, so what you learn from this is if you have things that sort of get bigger and bigger and are the same similar shape, the strength doesn't grow at the same rate as the volume or as the weight. So in some sense, you get weaker as you get bigger. And this is a nice little example. If you've got a cat and you've got a kitten, you can see this effect. The kitten is relatively stronger because it's smaller, and so it holds its tail sort of bolt upright like a spike. But as the cat gets bigger, it's relatively weaker compared with its weight, and its tail tends to curl over. It's not strong enough to hold the tail bolt upright anymore. So you see the strength to weight ratio is proportional to R squared over R cubed, 1 over R. So as R gets bigger, your strength to weight ratio gets smaller. And strength proportional to R squared, weight proportional to R cubed, that means your strength is proportional to your weight to the 2/3 power. Or if you don't like those fractions, your strength cubed is proportional to your weight squared. Okay? So if you just try to make people on the same body plan and make them bigger and bigger and bigger, like giants, they'll eventually break. They won't be strong enough to support their own weight. Similarly with buildings or with trees or with dinosaurs, there is a limit to how big they can be before the force on their base breaks the molecular bonds and they collapse. So let's test this rule, because what strength? That's the weight lifted, say, by the world weightlifting record holder, and the weight, well, it's their weight class. Weightlifters keep very careful statistics. They know the exact weight of the weightlifter for every lift that they record. And I did this some while ago. Numbers have probably been revised a bit these days. But what I want to see is the cube of strength, the cube of the weight lifted, proportional to the square of the weight of the weightlifter? So we're looking for a straight line. And here are the world records, okay? And here's the straight line. Cube of strength proportional to square of the weight lifted, square of the weightlifter's weight. It's a pretty good straight line, okay? Better than anything you'll see in economics or finance. Social science, never seen data fit as good as that. So you can see just by this very simple back of the envelope estimate, we have a pretty full understanding of what's going on in weightlifting. And similarly, if you were thinking about hammer throwing, you would expect strength really to follow the same trend. And in practice, of course, that's why all the hammer throwers are so enormous. You don't do hammer throwing if you're not, or you don't succeed at hammer throwing if you're not. Interesting thing at the top, the super duper weightlifter guy, you know, is as big as this building. He's pound for pound almost the weakest. Okay, he's below the line, because if he tried to be up on the line, he would tend to break some of his ligaments. He just can't handle the stress. The people that are most above this line to the left are the strongest, pound for pound, kilogram for kilogram. And the people to the right of it, like this one up here, are relatively the weakest. Well, let's move on to something rather different, rowing. And how should you organize your rowers to optimize the speed of a rowing boat? This is what rowers call the rig of the boat. And if you're not involved with rowing, you probably think, well, isn't there only one way to do it? You know, don't you have to go sort of left, right, left, right, left, right, left? And here with the four, right, left, right, left. And the answer is no, you don't. There's no rules about that. You can have right, right, left, left, right, right. You can organize them however you want. You better have the same number on each side or you'll start to go round in circles. My interest was aroused by this problem a few years ago, and I wrote a paper about it, which attracted a lot of interest. And I'll tell you what I was interested in. So I wanted to find out if there was an optimal way to seat the rowers, which stopped the boat wiggling. So if we think about a four to start off with for simplicity, then this is called the standard rig. So where you have sort of left, right. And the interesting thing about this configuration is that if you were to stand at one end of the boat and take moments of the forces that are acting on the boat, then there are two components of the force that each oar exerts on the boat when the rower pulls it against the rowlock. And one of those components is in the direction you want to go, that's the big one, but there's one at right angles to it, heading towards the boat, but only towards the boat during the first half of the stroke. And then the second half, you can imagine it, the oar is not pulling on the rowlock, you're in the sort of recovery phase, and this force changes direction and goes away from the boat. So this sideways force is sort of alternating. First half stroke, it comes towards the boat. Second half stroke, it goes away from the boat. So what's the moment of this force? This is what engineers and applied mathematicians refer to the amount of work that you have to do to overcome this. So it's the magnitude of the force times the distance to the point where it's applied. So if we stand at the end of the boat, the moment of this force from the first oar is this distance times the force plus this distance times the force plus this distance times the force plus this distance times the force. Well, if we do that for that configuration, let's suppose the distance to the first oarsman is S and then the spacing of the other oarsman is R. Then the moment from the sideways force from the first guy minus, because it's in this direction, the force N times that distance plus S plus R times the force in the other direction, plus S plus 2R times minus the force, plus S plus 3R times plus the force. Add them all together, they don't all cancel out. Those distances S do, but there is a non-zero sideways force. So this simple, usual way of rigging the boat ends up with an alternating force. The first half stroke pushes that direction, second half stroke goes in the opposite direction, the boat will slightly wiggle as it goes along. So you've got to use the rudder, if you've got a cox, you've got to steer and use energy up countering this wiggle. So I'm assuming four identical rowers, but you notice that if you were to seat them differently, if you were to have one here and then two in this direction and the fourth one like that, what's the moment of the force? Well, it's minus n times this distance s plus n times s plus r plus n times s plus 2r minus n times s plus 3r, and that's zero. So in this configuration there is no wiggle for four identical rowers. Well, this turns out to be known. It's known as the Italian rig. It was discovered almost by accident in the early 1950s by the best four in the world at the time, which was an Italian crew which was sponsored by Moto Guzzi and practiced on Lake Como. But what I then wanted to do was to figure out, well, what's the solution of this problem if you've got an 8? Well, going back to this, the S's always cancel out. And you've got minus N, well, NR plus 2NR minus 3NR. Forget about the NRs. It's 1 plus 2 minus 3 is naught. So the solution to these problems, if you've got 8 people, you're saying, well, we take the numbers 1 to 8. You've got 4 plus signs and 4 minus signs. How can you sprinkle them down so the sum is 0? And that gives you the configuration. The minus signs put the people on this side and the plus is on the other. So here's the first solution, and it's just taken two of those fours and put one after the other. So 1 minus 2 minus 3 plus 4 plus 5 minus 6 minus 7 plus 8 is 0. It's an easy way to check that. Go from the end. 1 plus 8 is 9, minus 2 minus 7 cancels it out. Minus 3 plus 4 is plus 1, plus 5 minus 6 minus 1. There are three other solutions to this problem and only three other solutions for the 8. One is to take this one and then flip it around. So it's still 0 plus 0. And that was also known and discovered by German crews long ago and used, in fact, this year to win the Olympic Games. These other two are new. So these are configurations. This one you see trialed. Imperial College, sponsored by New Scientist magazine, did some trials using this configuration last spring with interesting results. So what you found here, using simple number theory, what are the ways in which you can add the numbers 1 to 8 together, 4 plus signs and 4 minus signs, sum to 0, and these are the four configurations with no wiggle. You can prove some theorems from this, that it's not possible to have zero wiggle unless the number of rows is divisible by 4. So there's no zero wiggle 6, no zero wiggle 10, but there is for a 12 or a 16. And one of these configurations was used by Canada to win the Olympics in 2008. They used this configuration, and it's that one. And if you look carefully, you can see up here, his left, right, right, left, right, left. And this summer at the Olympic Games again, one of these configurations was used by the German crew to win. The last two boat races, Oxford versus Cambridge, also used some of these non-standard rigs. Well, the last topic I want to look at is about sprinting and about reaction times and about Usain Bolt, of whom you may have heard. And I had some interaction with his coach last week, and I'll mention about that in a moment. So Bolt is the best sprinter there's ever been, and his last two world records are huge improvements on previous 100-meter world records. So at the last Olympic Games in Beijing, he improved the 100-meter record to 9.68, and in the World Championships the following year to 9.58. He ran, I think, 9.63 at the Olympic Games a few months ago. And the interesting question is, how fast could he go in the future? And moderated by one comment, how fast could he go without actually becoming any better as a runner? So by applying a little bit of statistics and then a little bit of applied mathematics, we can get some perspective on how sensitive these records really are. How much could you expect them to improve? Because you see people writing to the newspapers saying, oh, it might be 100 years before, you know, we knock more than a few hundredths of a second off these records. So how much progress could we expect there to be? Well, there are three things that Bolt can focus upon. And the first is to recognize that Bolt is one of the worst reactors to the starter's gun in amongst all the top sprinters in the world. So this is not starting, it's just reacting. He has trouble starting sometimes. As his coach told me, he has a scoliosis. He has a curvature of the spine, sideways curvature of the spine, and one leg significantly shorter than the other. And so this causes problems and was one of the reasons he didn't run flat out in the 200-meter final of the Olympic Games in August. He was being bothered by this back pain, which may well end up curtailing his career. So when he set his world record, here are all the starters, and the time that you run in a 100 meters event is made of two pieces: the reaction time to the starter's gun plus the running time. So reaction time plus run time. And here is the reaction times of all the runners in that race. And you see Bolt really is rather slow, 0.146. The best reactors are 0.11, 0.129. But this person sort of fell out of the blocks, I think had an injury or it was a problem. So things were going wrong there. So he's almost sort of the second fastest reactor. And then in the Olympics themselves in Beijing, he was much slower still, 0.165, just like he was this time at the Olympics. So he's really he's the second slowest. So this is a general pattern. He responds very slowly to the starter's gun. Now, what's the benchmark? If you respond faster than 0.10, you will be defined as false starting. Okay. So the fastest you could legally respond is 0.10. So we'll try this out with someone in a moment. The very best starters in the world, so people who can consistently start at, say, 0.12 response time, not just once in a blue moon, because they're lucky. So someone like Colin Jackson, the previous hurdles world record holder, 0.12 every time, never a false start, very consistent. So that's the benchmark, 0.12, that's what the best people can do. So you can see that Bolt could improve his game, improve his time, simply by responding to the gun much more quickly, 0.12. So his coach tells me he works hard on this with other athletes. So it's a known problem, hasn't made much impact on it. Unfortunately, in the last World Championships a year ago, you remember he false started, was disqualified. So if he just was to improve his reaction time to 0.12 from his normal value, his time's down to 9.55 without any extra effort. If he improves to the limit, 0.10, he's down to 9.53. Well, what do reaction time statistics generally look like? And there's something very interesting here. Probably for 50 or 60 years, people have been studying reaction times for men and women, not athletes in particular, but ordinary members of the population. And there's been one rather stubborn result that's never gone away, and that is that there's a systematic difference between male and female average response times. Long ago, it was thought, back in the 1920s and 30s, this was just a reflection of the relative numbers of male and female drivers that there were, and that somehow being a driver, you know, made you more trained and practiced at responding quickly. But that's no longer the case today. But still there is this significant difference between male and female. So 0.1 of a second is 100 milliseconds. And here's a very interesting data set. It's the 425 sprint athletes at the Beijing Olympic Games on the track. And these are the histograms of the reaction times of all those athletes. Here are the males, here are the females. And you see this 168 to 191 is the difference between the means. And here's the 95% confidence limit. So this same result persists. And amusingly, if you then think about this, I thought one thing you should look at, you look at the false start statistics, and it reflects these fractions. So you have a very small number of false starts in all those events in Beijing by women, only 4, but 25 by men. And these are the ratios that you might expect from these type of differences in the mean. So female athletes much less likely to false start because of the very slightly slower reaction time. So this difference in the mean is not understood. Presumably it's linked directly to muscular strength in some way, just as the final times are. Well, let's see how you get on doing something reaction time. So I need someone to assist me to see if they can catch a $50 bill. If it's still here. So who's going to try this? How about gentleman's young lad sitting there in the white t-shirt? Yeah, you. No, not you. Yeah, you. You're going to be able to do this yourself in a moment. So just put your finger on either side of this bill. Okay, and so what I want you to do, I'm going to let go of it all of a sudden, and you'll try and catch it. Oh, bad luck. So try again. So, yeah. But let's try something that's sort of easier. So if I let go of this, now put your hand sort of further apart. So I'm going to let go of this, okay, and you've got much more chance to catch something. Okay, so you can sort of see it fell, what, from 18 to about, let's sort of 7 centimeters. Do it the other way around, then we don't have to calculate. Okay, so 7 inches rather. Yeah, it's about the same. Try one more time. Yeah, you're about the same. So each time you're at 8. So you can work out rather roughly how far something will fall under gravity. So when I let go of the banknote, in 0.1 of a second, which is the fastest time you could possibly react, what the neurophysiologic tests tell you, you know, it's going to go, in my estimate, I reckon about 5 centimeters. So it's impossible for you to catch that banknote unless you cheat. Shall I tell you how you can have a good chance? Okay, so if you think about it, that 5 centimeters is just the distance it's going to fall straight down. It's not even taking into account how long it takes you to move your fingers. But obviously, if you don't move your fingers like that, if you sort of move them down as well, you have a much better chance. So under some of the seats, there are some little pieces of paper. Thanks very much. That's good. So these are not $50 bills. Oh, dear. Or maybe they got $50 bills sort of inside, and if you sort of prize them apart. I don't know what happened to that $50 bill, actually. So you can try it for yourself. Okay. Well, let's push on and see the two other things that Mr. Bolt could do. If you know anything about track athletics and sprinting, you know that wind assistance is a big deal. And just as with the reaction time, there is a biggest wind assistance that you're allowed to have if you want to set a valid record. And you're not allowed to have a following wind that's bigger than 2 meters per second. This was chosen because back in the 1930s, when that was set as a rule and people only used stopwatches to record times, this was the amount of wind that mathematicians calculated would improve a time by 0.1 of a second. And stopwatches only distinguish times by 0.1 of a second, and the idea was that you didn't want a new world record to be set just because there was a wind. Well, Mr. Bolt, in fact, really doesn't have much help from wind. When he set his first world record, the wind was absolutely zero for 9.68, 0.0. This is very unusual. Usually when sprint 100-meter world records are set, the wind is almost at the maximum. People almost seek it out, in particular stadia in the world, to get a 1.8, 1.9 meter per second following wind. If you look at all the world records that were set in the sprints at the Mexico Olympics in 1968, incredibly suspicious. Most of them have 2.0 meter per second following wind. Exactly, you know, every time. Just valid. Somebody wanted to see a lot of records, I think. But when he set his second world record, the following wind was just 0.9. But this following wind is a big factor. So if he was to take advantage of a full following wind of 2 meters per second, what sort of difference does it make? Well, if this is Mr. Bolt running along in wind of air density rho, say, and he's going at speed v, and his body presents an area A to the air he's running through, then the drag force that you feel as you run through air is proportional to the air density. So if you run in treacle, you feel more air resistance. You run at high altitude, you feel less. If you run on a hot day, feel less. At the velodrome at the Olympics in London last month, they heated the air at track level in a cycle velodrome, so as to lower the air density at track level, so all the cyclists would go faster, less drag, more likely to set records. Big difference, you know, air temperature 10 degrees centigrade difference, 1.5 seconds over 4 kilometer pursuit distance. It's a lot. But then it depends on your area. So if you've got lots of flappy clothing and you have a large area you're presenting to the wind, you're going to feel more drag. So that's why cyclists try to reduce the area they present when they're cycling on the road, try to reduce the drag. You can run behind people, that really helps. But you can't do that, of course, in the 100 meters. But what if there's a wind blowing? Then the drag force on you is not the speed you're going anymore, it's your speed relative to the wind. Because you've got a wind behind you, okay, you have to use less effort to overcome the air density. So the drag force depends on the square of your speed minus the wind speed when the wind is behind you. If you're going into the wind, this changes sign, the wind is negative, it's much harder work. So it's nonlinear. You don't gain going down the back straight with the wind behind you what you lose coming down the home straight going into the wind. So if Mr. Bolt was to improve his performance by finding that 2 meter per second following wind, he improves his 9.58 to 9.55 by a bit quicker off the mark, okay, reacting a bit faster, he could improve to 9.49 by just letting the wind go up to 2.0 meters per second. So this is a big improvement. So you're under 9.5 without running any faster. But what about the last factor? Suppose you want that thinner air, that lower density. You go to high altitude, you'll never get the chance to run the Olympics at Mexico City ever again. That mistake will not be made again. Mexico City is at 2,240 meters above sea level. Now, if you want to set a record in athletics that's not designated as being set, especially at altitude, you can't perform at a height of more than 1,000 meters above sea level. That's the limit. So if you went to 1,000 meters, then you gain 0.03 of a second straight away, just through the air being thinner. If you go up to Mexico City, it's 0.07. So that was the gain from altitude alone in those Mexico City results. So here's what our little bit of mathematical analysis of the possibilities for Mr. Bolt tell you, that his 9.58 goes to 9.55 by being a little more alert and seeking out a good wind, 9.49, go to the highest altitude that you can find that's legal, 9.46, and you haven't got any better. Okay, so there really is huge scope to improve his record over 100 meters just by twiddling with these variables that you understand by some mathematical analysis of the running environment. Okay, well, I think we've used up our time. You've got to do some walking in a straight line, and you can ask some questions maybe before. If you want to know more about applications of mathematics to all sorts of other sports, inevitably I have a book about this. And in America it has a different title to what it has in England. In England it's 100 essential things you didn't know about sport. But here, so it fits on the page, it's just called Mathletics. There are in this book 100 examples of ways in which a little mathematical insight tells you something about all sorts of different sports. And we try to cover everything that you would find in the Olympic Games all sorts of massive scoring systems, archery, judo, swimming, which is the most technical of all mathematically, and so on. So I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have, and then you can practice your walking in a straight line.
It's very interesting analysis you did on Usain Bolt, but I think there's one thing literally that you are missing, which is that when he doesn't do this all the time, but often when he is ahead, as he's reaching the finish line, he slows down to not overexert himself. Now, I don't recall if the Beijing record was one where he did this, but I wonder if that, how much of an impact that would have were he to run at full speed all the way through the tape.
Yeah, the Beijing record, he did ease up a little, but I think the Berlin one he did not, and the Beijing 200 meters he did not. He claims easing up is not, his coach told me, is not just showmanship, but he's very nervous about this back injury situation. And the first event that he does at a championship, he's got lots of races to come. He's got the 200 meters to come. He's got the relay to come. He really doesn't want to go flat out in that first event and chance not being able to run the others. So he's trying to balance these sort of biomechanical problems that he has with spine curvature and sort of uneven leg length and so forth.
Can I ask a question about the handedness in tennis? So it's true that for the left-hander, it will usually be match point. He'll be on his forehand. But that just means he'll have returned as many points forehand as backhand, right? Whereas if you have match point at 40-15, then for the right-hander, he'll actually have had a chance to have one more point on his forehand than the backhand. So I wonder that sort of privileging of the last point, the sort of most dramatic point, the match point, if that's really the correct analysis or not. I mean, you can certainly make the case that it actually favors the right-handed tennis player.
It seemed to me the best one to make in that this was the critical point, okay, in the game. You know, you've got to win that next point. I mean, of course, for top-class players, I suspect it's less of a problem, you know, not serving on your forehand court. You know, they're so good that they overcome this. But I read an interview the other day by McEnroe, you know, who just, I don't know when he gave the interview, but he just regarded it as sort of obvious that it was biased towards left-handers. If you switch the rule so the game started on the left-hand court, the opposite would be true. Okay. But I expect for the ordinary club player who's not so expert at dealing with the serve that's not, you know, on the forehand, it's a more pronounced problem. If you look at other games, table tennis, the problem doesn't arise because you can serve from anywhere in table tennis. You can stand wherever you want. Badminton, it arises, but there are so many points that are being played, you know, that the statistics are far less overtly biased one player than another. Gentleman, right at the back.
In terms of the tennis, there just seems to be a lot of psychological ability.
Yeah, in my book, one of the chapters is about what, you know, you might call psychological momentum. You know, so you can do a simple statistical analysis of, you know, if you're the better player by some small amount, you know, for each shot, how much advantage do you have, you know, at the end of a game, the end of a set? But you might then add in, well, if you win a set, you know, maybe you have a sort of psychological boost, you know, factor that you add on to the probabilities or multiply them for the next set. And similarly, you divide out and reduce for the losing player. So these factors are important. Interestingly, I mentioned that, you know, this balance between cooperation and competition. The people that had done that research, and so I was in contact with them, and we wanted to then do an analysis of major tennis performances, you know, on the circuit, point by point, to try and understand what was happening with right and left-handers. But we couldn't do this for the most bizarre reasons. IBM sponsors international tennis and claims ownership of all that data. So it wouldn't release to us any ball-by-ball data about high-level tennis and claimed it owned the data. Of course, you could have watched, you know, and kept, but you couldn't have watched all the games. So I suspect when I looked at the Wimbledon Championship website in the summer, it was clear they have some commercial interest, that they're trying to generate programs which they're then going to sell to coaches and tennis players that do sort of systematic statistical analysis of different types of performance, different responses. So we couldn't do this analysis to see whether the data really backed up this statement. Nor would they even tell us who we could ask in the company to gain permission to do it. So it's a real trade secret.
I'm wondering if you've done any work with golfers. There are a lot of golfers out there, and there are a lot of swings, but seems the smallest variability in some aspect of the swing produces a horrible effect, even on the pro tour. So have you done any work in that area?
Various things about golf. Again, there's a moment of inertia issue, you know, with the club head design and stability and so forth. I have a whole talk that I once gave about, you know, flights of golf balls, which are complicated. You know, they're not just projectiles in the simple sense, but they spin and they move through air and they experience lift, and when they land, they maybe backspin. So it's a good topic. And in fact, the first person that studied golf mathematically was a very famous mathematical physicist, Tate, whose name is usually linked with Lord Kelvin. Kelvin and Tate, lots of research work together, lots of books together. And Tate was a good golfer, and his son was an even better golfer, champion golfer. And he wrote two papers in 1905, which were published in Nature, about trajectories of golf balls. So looking at projectiles that were spinning and moving through air, which behave quite differently to ordinary projectiles. Shuttlecocks in badminton show you even more dramatic behavior. You know, the ball has a straight line trajectory and then it drops, so there's a maximum distance you can hit it. Actually, during the Olympics, I got an email from a doctor in Canada who had a golf problem. That he had an argument with his fellow golf players, and he wanted me to solve this argument. And what it was, he said, when we walk around the course, I claim it's easier to pull my golf cart, but the people that play with me say it's best to push it. Who's right? Well, the simplest analogy, it's best to pull it. You know, because when you pull it, the frictional force resisting the motion is proportional to the downward component of the weight, okay? And when you pull, that force is partly upwards. But when you push, you tend to push downwards. And so there's much more downward component of the weight. That's why those airport baggage trolleys are so awful to move. Because you're tending to push them down. You're increasing the weight of your stuff by the weight plus the component of your push downwards. Whereas when you pull, the effective weight is the actual weight minus the component pulling upwards. So that was my contribution to golf mobility, cart mobility. But you're quite right. The flight of golf balls, the spin of golf balls, the fact that it's very sensitive, it's one of these events that has this type of chaotic sensitivity. So like snooker or pool, if you make a slight miscue, you get a big error. So this is characteristic of a chaotic situation. So you don't, if you make an epsilon error, you don't just make an epsilon bad result, but it's 2 to the power epsilon, so it sort of doubles the error. And this is why people like it. Yeah, so the question was, when we looked at this curve, this graph, you know, is there a curve, is it asymptotic up here? As I indicated, there would certainly be a cutoff. So if you tried to make the weight of a weightlifter become, you know, arbitrarily large, they would eventually break. Now, in fact, in the world of weightlifting, this sort of modeling, this type of modeling is done vary in much greater detail. And I think it's called Simpson's formula. Simpson, a mathematician at MIT, who was a weightlifter. And just by fitting data, instead of just a two-thirds power law, there's a sort of exponential with a fraction, very complicated formula that fits this data very accurately. And it's taking into account this feature that as people start to get very heavy, they start to be a bit limited just by the structural strength of their skeleton. And what weightlifters do with that super accurate formula is not just sort of give lectures about it, as it were, but they like to be able to sort of compare the performances of weightlifters in different weight classes to actually argue who is best, you know, and attribute points according to who is the strongest pound for pound. And they use that much more detailed data fitting curve to do that rather than just this simple rule. But you can see just from this rule, you really get to the crux of what's going on. And say the more simple rule of Simpson's is, I think it's Simpson, is a fit to the data of all the weightlifters that you've got. And then you sort of shift them all back as though they all had the same weight and see who's really the strongest. So weightlifting really likes statistics and comparable performance. Yeah. Yes? The question was, who thought up those power law formulae for the points in decathlon? I think they were first created in 1936, when this event, you know, was coming along at the Olympic Games, and the idea was to produce for the first time tables of performances and to try to fit those rules in the simplest way that one could. And by taking all the performances in decathletes and by decathletes, these parameters are giving you the best fit, as it were, to the performances. So this is why you get this huge variance, you see. If you're creating the point system from past experience, you're just going to reinforce any biases that existed in the past. Okay, but you would never get away with changing it dramatically. If you look at other sports where you don't add the points, like the triathlon, that always seems manifestly unfair. You have a swim, and you have a bike ride, and you have a run. And the swim lasts for about 18 minutes, the bike ride lasts for about 65 minutes, and the run lasts for about 30 minutes. So you can see that it's hugely biased, really, towards the length of the cycle and run phases. Triathletes don't like swimming, and they tend to be very good at swimming. And if you're a good swimmer, you wouldn't take up the triathlon. You're not going to get a good return for your ability. But if you tried to do this sort of thing for the different events, if you were to look at the swim statistics, it's not very useful. The swimmers all stick together. You know, there's a long way to go. And there's a tiny variance on the performance of the field in the triathlon and the swim. They're saving themselves. Often they're swimming without using their legs much because they're going to use the legs on the bike ride. So the swim is the only place they use their arms. So if you doubled the length of the swim, reduced the length of the bike ride, and reduced the length of the run a bit, you could make the time spent on each of the three sections about the same. So in my chapter in the book on equi-tempered triathlon, this is a sort of tongue-in-cheek proposal, that you restructure the triathlon so you spend equal time on each of the disciplines. You could then argue, well, equal time doesn't mean equal effort. Okay, but you could then argue about that. But at the moment, it's very structured towards benefiting cyclist runners. Okay, last question.
Is there such thing as home field advantage or home country advantage in the Olympics, or as simple as being home at Yankee Stadium?
Oh, yes. There certainly is. And in some sports, it's really rather obvious. I mean, suppose you take the velodrome, you know, in cycling, where there's sort of subtle differences of curvature on that track. The home cyclists have been practicing on that track almost every day. You know, for the past couple, you know, since the track's been open. Other countries have to be given access, but in practice they can't take up the same amount of time on the course. If you're a distance runner, you can run around large sections of the marathon course. So there are many sports where you actually try out the facility. The canoeing slalom course, you know, with all the rapids and so forth. If you've had a good lot of goes on that, it's very advantageous compared with people who haven't. And, you know, you're used to the climate. You're just down the road. You don't have to travel to the other side of the world. Things are not strange. So I think there's a big home advantage. But probably there's a second order effect, really, that when you are the home nation, because of this advantage, you invest massively, like Britain did, in your sports facilities and your athletes, you know, to really take advantage of being the home nation. So you put much more support in. You enter more athletes because it doesn't cost as much to send them. So there are all these rather sort of non-linear factors. Okay, well, thank you very much.